Hey, welcome more gamers, Doug here from 2 Plus Stuff, and today I wanted to talk about a game called Skytear. Okay. A couple weeks ago, towards the end of last year, I was reached out to by a company called PVP Geeks, and they were looking for people to do unboxing copies, or reviews and that kind of stuff, for their new game, Skytear, which I just talked about here. And I started looking into the company a little bit more. They seem like really awesome people. So they did send me a free copy, so that's just for me doing an unboxing. I just want to put that out there to be very transparent. But I wanted to talk about this because it's a very interesting game. We hear a lot about gateway games, right, as far as like getting younger folks or folks who are not experienced with wargaming at all into the idea of using miniatures and painting them and that kind of stuff. And how do we get people into the greater miniature wargaming hobby? I think this is a pretty cool start. We're going to talk about kind of the foundings of it. And then really the bulk of this video is going to be an unboxing video, talking about the contents of it. Kind of my overall thoughts. We'll come back at the end and kind of review it all. But we'll go piece by piece. We'll talk about the models. We'll talk about the cards and the gameplay and that kind of stuff. And I'll kind of give my final thoughts. So like I said, this was a successful, very successful actually, Kickstarter. They actually hit 41, I believe, of their... like their, their goals that are beyond the initial ask. And I think that was really, really cool. And if you don't know what kind of game this is, Skytear is basically a MOBA-inspired thing. So if you think of probably the most popular MOBA out there is League of Legends, something like that, where you and your opponent, or you have teammates, and you're trying to work together to destroy your enemies, and you do so with powerful heroes that have all been kind of customized, designed, they have their cool little backstory and abilities, and you use these little minions to go get that job done. This does much of the same thing. In this box, there are 8 powerful heroes that you can use, as well as I think there's like 16 minions, little monsters that have their own rules that are really used to destroy enemy bases, and you have to then fight through various like fields of battle and kind of secure your own objectives while denying your opponent theirs. It is a very cool thing. Now, if your heroes die, they do come back just like they do in the online version. And so it really, really is, I'm not gonna say it's a analog version of like League of Legends or something like that. It's not. It has its own very unique things, and I'm going to talk about those because there's some really cool stuff here they do. There's no dice in this game, which is a unique thing, but the card mechanic is very interesting, and we'll dive into that in a little bit. But that suffice to say, that's kind of the game we're talking about. I'll throw some pictures up here, and realistically what it is, because I don't have a camera big enough to accommodate the map that they give you. It's not all that massive. I just mostly just focus on painting small things, so I never had a camera for that. But really what it is, it's you get your square board, and you and your opponent are trying to either A, destroy your opposing army's tower, or you also have your own set of objectives. And so there are asymmetrical objectives in this game, meaning that you and your opponent have different goals. And so you have to be mindful of stopping them from achieving theirs while also achieving yours. There are going to be expansions for having different boards in the future, like different numbers of lanes and that kind of thing to increase complexity, as well as allow for more players in the future. In addition to all of that, they're kind of treating this like kind of like they do with online games, where you have your starting roster, which is of course the 8 heroes you get here that come from 4 kind of distinct backgrounds / abilities. And then in the future, as they unleash them upon the world, there's going to be these little fun expansion packs which come with 4 more heroes each, as well as a few minions that work for all of them, and some more stuff like that. So there is a few bit of elements to the game. So it has some depth, it has some legs. I can see it becoming a very easy access point when it comes to like league play, in terms of like getting a bunch of people together to play these kinds of games. As far as pricing goes, I think this is where it really shines. You see, we're going to talk about the miniatures in a little bit, and they're not the same level as, say, like Games Workshop, where they're very intense models for people who can be professional modelers. These are much more relaxed, they're much more easygoing, much more close to like a Reaper level of miniature and detail. However, the price point for this box, at least on the Kickstarter, it came out to be roughly $71. It hasn't hit the US market yet, but I believe that is the target goal for them. So to get an entry-level game with a lot of versatility and playability and some deck building aspects and that kind of stuff for that price point, I do think is really, really good. Because like, I don't know if you've been to a game store lately, but like getting 2-4 player, which is what this is, board game honestly anymore can be like $100 and something. It's kind of crazy. So what I'm gonna do now is transition to my downward cam over here on the hobby desk. And we're gonna chat about the contents of the box in terms of like the miniatures mostly. I'll throw some pictures up to get some better detail for you there. And then we're gonna move into kind of more how the game plays with the card system and that kind of thing. I did the initial impressions video a little bit early, and then I retroactively asked a few more questions before doing this section of the video. And so when that's all done, we'll come back, we'll wrap up. I have some closing thoughts and clarifications, and then we'll talk about the overall value of the game. Again, I'm gonna say, assume all of this, that price point is in that $75-ish range, which is, I think, is definitely their target. So here we are at the downward cam here. And as you can see, this is the nice box of Skytear. It's a big old tall sucker, so it's a little bit hard to fit on camera all at once, but I went ahead and opened it up ahead of time just to make sure all the contents were there and kind of familiarize myself with it. In the box, when you first open it, this is pretty much what you see. Some of the cards and stuff I already took out to review separately, but functionally, this is really what it is. There are, I believe, four different like types of like kind of sub team in here that you and your opponent can kind of construct how you want to play the game, basically. And this big nasty looking monster dude here kind of hovers in the center of the game board, and he's kind of like a non-player character. He'll attack anyone who gets too close. This is actually a terrific looking model. Like, it's hard to show up on camera because the light doesn't quite show you all the little details, but this is a terrific looking model. Now, as for the other ones, there were, I will admit, some packaging issues, I will say, to be fair. For example, this one, actually, I took it out early and did a little bit of work on it, but her elbow, where it meets the robe right there, and I'll show you pictures when it's all painted, the packaging here kind of bowed it a little bit too hard, so I had to fix that with some green stuff. And this gentleman with the scimitar thing just needed to be, it wasn't broken, it was just coming loose, so I just threw some extra glue on it. But everything else, it's just those two characters that have the weapons that are pretty far from their bodies. Everything else came pretty perfectly. All your little minion guys are so fun that I think they're quite funny. And you're gonna use them to capture or destroy the enemy base, while your heroes there have all kinds of cool abilities and are there to kind of support them doing the lion's share of the work. And I think that's a neat kind of combination. Here you have your cards. Now, it's not, there is a, I'll say this correctly, it's not a deck building game, though there are cards that you can swap out with expansions, kind of like this little expansion here. And honestly, like, but it's not marketed as a deck building game. I really don't think it is, from what I've seen, but there are some cool other options available to some of the heroes that come in these secondary sets that have some crossover. And so it's one of those things that, like, you know, honestly, I don't see this being like a highly competitive in your face game. It's going to be a lot of fun. And if you were to pick up an expansion or two based on some cool models, you get some extra options. I've looked at the cards that come in the expansions, and honestly, they don't seem vastly different. So I wouldn't worry about like a power level break or anything like that. And in the bottom, we'll start off here very simply. You get your tokens. These are all very, very highly detailed. I won't pop it out of there because it's going to wreck the work of the box if I do. But very, very thick, nice cardstock to be able to keep track of stuff. And of course, the board itself, which I'll take some bigger pictures of and show them for you. Honestly, it's coffee table sized. I like it. The graphic of the actual board itself is quite striking. It's this beautiful landscape with the board all kind of split in twain. And there's a lot of cool stuff going on. And so this is really it for the core set, at least as far as the big things go. Let me throw these cards back here. And I actually want to show off something else. And that is the way that the expansion packs come. This one, unfortunately, I already tore it open. I didn't see how it was packaged in the box when they sent it to me, so I kind of just grabbed it by this corner here. And so this would be a typical expansion box where it comes with, realistically, one team. I mentioned before that there were like four teams in the core set, where there's two heroes and four minions. This is the same thing, basically. You pick two of these heroes, you get your four minions, and those can be played as a team with the other set. I actually like that quite a bit. Also included, but was out of the box, was the cards that come with this. And like I said, obviously most of the cards here are dedicated to the specific characters that come in here. There's just one or two, I think, that can be swapped out. There's just a few. I mean, one or two might not be accurate, but just a few that can be swapped out, and they're packaged in a near identical way. This one is kind of fun because it has like a Gaia, goddess of life, and a mermaid, and this guy who's like a frost armadillo that I like quite a bit. And again, I'll be showing pictures of all these once they're all painted. But fundamentally, the sense that I get from this, right? And again, they sent me a review copy. Take it for what it's worth. The thing I like about this is, from this specific perspective, right, of the packaging and the handling and all that stuff, it's a self-contained game. There is different ways to play it because there's different combinations of those little teams. You get some cool looking models. I will be honest with you and say that they are somewhere in between like miniature game level and something more akin to a board game, which honestly is kind of the space that this game occupies. And that's actually all right. I mean, they don't have to be groundbreaking sculpts, each and every one of them, but they do their purpose really, really well. And there's some cool things you can do. I'm going to attack these with some contrast paints from Games Workshop, and you'll see that there's actually quite a bit of depth and detail. They really can come to life if you put a little bit of work into them. That all being said, the only thing I had to say negatively about the packaging and the way it comes is these two specific models, just because of their poses, they're a little bit rough to transport, I can imagine. It could just be the way that they shifted in the box, like in transit for mine. Hers is kind of the bigger issue. Him, I could see it, you know, he just got clipped on the side here by a total accident or shifted in place, but hers is, the scythe is so far out there that I can definitely see that being a reoccurring problem. But again, you know, take that for what it is. It was just my one copy. The truth is, for someone who's like, you know, getting into that kind of transitioning from maybe video games, because it is, again, based off of a MOBA, into miniatures, it is actually a really good set of models. You get quite a few models to practice painting on. They're very well textured, and so they take to things like contrast very well, as you will see. And I think it's an overall high quality set. For the price that this kind of comes in at, it is a very high quality set. So moving more into like how the game actually functions, I want to talk about the cards that you get. And these are the same kinds of cards that you get in the expansion packs here. And really what they come down to is, very, very simply put, you have your victory conditions. What's cool about this game is, of course, there is always the victory condition of destroying your enemy's tower, but there's also other ways to win. And these could be things like, for example, this one is double kill, defeat two enemy heroes within a single hero activation. Then that's a hard one to get, defeat three enemy heroes. And basically you and your opponent are in a race to achieve basically any of the victory conditions first. And what I like about that is it's asymmetrical gameplay. You know your victory conditions and you know your opponents, and you're in a race to accomplish those goals. You need to balance, you know, am I gonna give my opponent a chance to score here? That kind of stuff. Very, very interesting things. Of course, below that you have your cards for your various characters. As I said before, you get two characters for each of the four factions. And they do some pretty cool stuff, and I'll come back to these in a second when we review the other ones for some context. Down below that are reference cards for you. These are extremely handy because looking at the rule book to learn your specific faction's special abilities is quite cumbersome. And really what it comes down to is they can all kind of do similar things, okay? So when you start, you can either move, skirmish. So think of it this way. Movement is obviously just moving. Move three hexes. Skirmish is you get to move two hexes and attack. It's kind of like a charge move if you would think of in any other game, right? Where you do a movement plus an attack. And there's some different conditions there. You can just do a basic attack if you're already in range of somebody. You can do what's called a lead, which is basically to use one of your power cards to augment your hero to make them better at something. Or each faction, this is really where, frankly, the only part where the reference cards matter is called worship. Worship is when you use your faction special ability. So for example, we'll go with the red one here since that's what I got. They can mark somebody. They apply a marked condition to a target. And so basically, if you look at their card, they all have these special abilities where if you have an enemy that is marked, she can teleport to them across the board. And that's kind of a cool thing, right? So she can teleport to people. He does explosive damage, so he hurts the hero that he's attacking. And if that person is marked, he hurts all the little minions around him. So it's stuff like that where they get to do some special thing that makes them unique. And this is your reference card for that. The blue one is actually my favorite, where this is a faction of shapeshifters. And so this is like a guy going whole hog, turning into a bear, you know, that kind of thing, where that's their worship ability. The Aztec, the green ones, they tend to focus a lot on movement and ambush and that kind of stuff. They can like set up teleportation points and kind of move around the board that way. There's all kinds of cool things. So that's, I think, where a lot of the depth comes from these factions in terms of playing. And what's cool about it is basically you and your opponent, you're both going to pick two. You can roll off or whatever, decide for that. Not roll off because there's no dice in this game. But basically, you're going to pick two factions. And from that, you get your pool of abilities that you can use. Now, I'm going to talk about these cards. As I just said, there's no dice in this game. And people are like, how do you have a dice game or a miniatures game without dice? Really, what's cool about this game, I'll put this off to the side. This is just a card that anyone can use, so it doesn't really matter. Here's your faction-specific ones, the ones that I think are actually interesting. The thing about this game is you have abilities, and then you have these little numbers up here in the top left. When you do an attack, and we'll take our bear boy here, he's going to do 3 damage, and you see there's a little card symbol. I'm not sure how well that shows up for you. A little card symbol right there. That means that it is 3 damage plus a card from the top of your deck, and that kind of acts as the random element of the game. So we'll take this blue one. If this is my deck, I attack with the bear guy. He does 3 damage plus an additional 3, right? And so he does 6 damage total. There's no saves or anything like that because this is a MOBA game. Your heroes die and the next round they come back, right? And that's how the game keeps progressing, just like a MOBA if you're playing a video game. So that's how that works. But here's the thing that I think is unique about that. What you're balancing is, do I want to keep and draw new cards, right, to get the cool effects that you can use? Or do you want to keep them in your deck because you want better modifiers when you go to do attacks? And that's the cool resource tension that exists in the game, is that oftentimes cards will, you know, be good at one or the other or good at both, and you have to balance, okay, do I want to keep this for the ability that it offers that gives me an edge, or do I need that, like, you know, for example, +2 modifier when it comes to doing attacks and damage? And that's kind of the variable, right? So instead of rolling a die for things, you're always flipping the cards and using the resource of your abilities, burning those abilities, if you will, to be able to use those modifiers. And that's a really interesting design idea that I hadn't quite thought of before. But when you combine it with some of their unique abilities, right, the faction abilities, it gets very, very interesting. So all in all, I think these elements come together to make a very interesting game. You have asymmetrical objectives where you're trying to, you know, destroy your opponent. You have very unique class-based abilities that use a balancing factor of opportunity cost is really what it is, in terms of the abilities you have to achieve your goals with the raw numbers and modifiers that you need to get the job done in a reasonable way. Like I said, you can look at the health pool of these guys. Like, you know, they will die, they will take damage, and it looks like they're somewhere between 14 and 18, generally speaking. That's the range. A lot of them rank in the 18. Yeah, there's quite a few 18. They all have like a heavy hitter who's at least 18. And the reason that's important is because, you know, they are going to die and they will come back to be able to keep achieving objectives. And so there's a lot of teleport abilities in this one. The yellow faction, I can't remember their name off the top of my head. They have this cool thing where they can project an illusion of themselves. And so that illusion can act in their place and be a contestant for stuff like that. And it kind of does cool things like that. So now you have to fight sort of two heroes, but really only one of them is the actual hero. It's kind of a fun, unique makeup there. Like I said, I'm a big fan, frankly, if I'm going to be honest with you. I like balancing opportunity cost. In all the games I play, you've heard me say this about Age of Sigmar. I talked about it a long, long time ago when I was playing War Machine and Hordes. I love when you get a cool bonus, but there's an immediate drawback, like a noticeable drawback. And then this is exactly that mechanic put into action when it comes to dice. It's opportunity cost. The fact that you have stuff like you can disarm a hero, meaning that prevents them from attacking you. But to do that, you have to give up a sweet modifier because most of these are plus zero and plus one. And so it's all about that. Is it worth giving up this opportunity of these abilities for that modifier and back and forth? And I love that tension. Now, I will say up front that that is going to be a big deal when it comes to future expansions. They need to maintain the good balance of those opportunity costs. And kind of incentivize you to fill your deck with cards that have good numerical bonuses but terrible abilities, kind of a thing, and vice versa. What you don't want to see is a whole bunch of cards or exclusive cards that are just perfect at everything, right? I think that's the real issue when it comes to these kinds of things. Looking through the deck, I don't see any that are that painfully obvious. But, you know, the opportunity is there, and that's, you know, every game has its thing where it's like, you can look at it and be like, that's going to where it's going to need some rebalancing. You could see that. But again, that exists in every single game, video game version or not. And I think this is no different. And I think it comes up with a really cool solution to the dice mechanic. Okay, and I wanted to crack open the expansion so that you can see how they're going to develop this game going forward. Of course, I already showed off the models with, you know, you have your four heroes and your minions to go with them. I have here the hero cards. And so I got the Leothian expansion, which is the shapeshifter, the blue team, basically, to put it really bluntly. And one of the things that's cool, if you look at some of these hero cards, I didn't touch on this earlier and I really should have. Some of them have dual factions. So, for example, Armadillo Ice Guy here. Brilvar is both the blue faction, meaning the shape-shifting kind, but also the green Aztec-y kind. And then we have, they're all obviously blue because they're all fit into that same theme, but we have one from, we have two from the green and two from the light, which is like the illusionist, that kind of thing. And I think that's really, really neat. Now, the reason I bring that up is because in the deck of cards that you get with them, there are some cards that are specific to certain heroes. For example, this is specific to Shilavi, which is like a spellcasting type shapeshifter lady. Very cool stuff. And there are some copies of the cards from the core base set, which is actually nice because that way, if you decide to go, you know, lean super heavy into like the blue team, you have two sets of blue teams, you can have doubles and build your deck that way. However, I was surprised, I didn't see it at first, that there are a few cards that work for any faction in here, and those are these three. You do get three of them, which is an interesting thing. I'm not quite sure why you'd want all three of them, but they do work for any faction, so no matter what you have. Most of the cards fit in the theme of whatever box you got. So for example, this is the Leothan, which is the blue shapeshifters, you know, for lack of a better term, just because I'm not familiar with the name and neither are you guys. Most of the cards are from there, but if you go towards the back, something interesting is that you do get cards from other factions. So these are three for the light faction, three for the green, the Aztec theme guys. And the reason is because these heroes, if they have both of those symbols, they can use those cards, which is an interesting thing because at that point, what it means is, if you have the base set and you have this set, these are cards that can be used by the green team and the, you know, the light team from the base set as well. So you're expanding kind of all of the options. The only thing that's not represented is none of the red ones, which is an interesting change. So that's the only thing you wouldn't gain from this. But I like the idea that these heroes can use spells and abilities from other factions, but it's in a somewhat limited way, and I think that's a really cool idea. As far as the how good the abilities are, I just now noticed as I was looking at them that they are three copies of the same card, and I wonder how many times that happens. Like, there's one, two, three. Okay, so there's multiple times where you get copies of the same card, and I'm sure that's for deck building. And I really do think that this is intended to be kind of a communal game, as like an element of sharing cards and kind of building cool decks with you and your friends. So some copies would not be a bad idea. So all in all, I just wanted to show off the expansions, and I forgot to mention, yeah, that some of the heroes have dual factions, and so they can double dip from different ability cards and that kind of stuff, which I think adds a little bit of fun to it. Now, I personally, I would not go super hardcore to the deck building aspect of it. That's not really me. But on the whole, I like the idea that there's a diversity of abilities out there for your units. And so now, kind of putting it all back together, I want to kind of give my final thoughts on the game, capital G, and then also as a product. So as a product, let's talk about this, right? This is an unboxing video for this box, and sort of as an asterisk, the expansions. What I will say, of course, it depends on the final price point when it finally hits stores, because this is all before it hits stores. If it's in that $75 to $85 range, I think this is a great deal. And the reason is, it is perfect for, to be perfectly frank, parents who want to get their kids off of video games but still experience and engage their hobbies with them. I think this is awesome. You know, a lot of people love MOBA games, being able to detach them from a computer screen to sit down and just have a fun gaming experience. There's some really cool stuff here. Don't overlook that. I mean, there's plenty of parents out there who just want to connect with their kids more. Furthermore, if you're on this channel, you probably love miniature wargaming. As far as miniatures go, they are really, really, like, they're fun. You know what I mean? I don't know if I would classify them as like being super intensely detailed, but you do get quite a few of them. So even if you just want a side fun game with some friends for game night, and you just want some, frankly, models to practice painting on, you kind of can't do better than this, because even the Reaper stuff is going to run you higher than that just to get a bunch of things just to try paint out on. If you don't want to paint them, don't bother. Don't bother. They work perfectly fine without it. What I will say is there's quite a bit of artwork in the book. It's kind of fun to look at. And there's actually quite a bit of customizability in this set. Like I said, there are four factions represented, each with two heroes. And so you can see, obviously, there's some combinations to how you build your armies there. And then obviously when you start getting into expansions, which my understanding, these are going to be about $30, $35 a piece, which is frankly a lot of a lesser value to me. But again, one box of this, because of the cards and the models, and you get four heroes, which is awesome. You know, I think it does add quite a bit to the existing set. Like just this plus this, which would roughly come out to be about 110, I think. There's just a lot of versatility into how you can play the game and expand upon it. And these are just simply not necessary, and that's an important part. Now, as far as like the game, capital G, right, Skytear as a whole, there are a few things that are really, really cool. So for example, if we go over to their website, you will see, oh, there it is. Yeah, there's a whole bunch of stuff here where you have everything from an overview that explains the game. And I'll put links to this down below if you're curious. You can be introduced to the different heroes, meaning all the different characters that you can play as in this game. There's tutorials. And then if you look down where it says community, this is actually my favorite part, is all the information is out there for you. And so if you or a loved one who, like, you know, or your friends really get into this game, you can go here and you can build your own custom deck of cards. You can look to see where the cards that you want are, so you can get the right expansions and all that stuff. It's very easily expandable. What I would say is just buy the core set if it interests you, and then kind of go from there, gauge some interest, and then build from there. We'll just take a look here right quick. This is the full card library I was talking about, where you can organize them by the different like four factions, the kind of power level you're looking for, and as well as victory conditions. And so this is the kind of stuff I'm talking about, where the company put a great deal of work into making all the information accessible. So, you know, even though you can understand people's pushback to like, oh, I don't want to have to buy a game with a bunch of expansions, that sales model is very cumbersome because you just feel like you're always buying things. But the truth is that they give you all the information to make the smartest purchases possible. And I like that. I think that is important. So these little databases, and they give you all the tools you need to do everything you want to do, I think is a really cool thing. The fact that then you can also look at the different heroes like we're looking at here. Sorry, it took a second to load. And you can just pick out characters that you think sound really, really cool. Gives you a sense of like, you can get excited about stuff in the future, even knowing what you have now. So all that stuff, I love it. I love when companies take the time to really invest in their own product. And while this might seem like a low cost, no thrills, you know, frankly, board game, the fact of the matter is they've set themselves up to be in this perfect space between a full-blown miniatures game that's super crazy and is like, you know, an investment of a lifetime, like say Warhammer or, you know, any of the other games, versus something that is a board game. It's right in this nice middle zone, and I think that's great. I think there's a niche for that. So kind of closing out my thoughts here as far as the value of the box. Like I said, there's no official price point yet, but assuming it's in that $75 to $85 range, I like this. I would say buy this first and just try the game out. Me and Jess are going to be playing some games once I get the minis painted so that we can record them and that kind of stuff. And I can share some like super final thoughts towards the end. There are some cool sculpts. There's lots of list design between the four factions in here. You each take control of two of them. I think that's really neat. And then when it comes to the expansions, that's the one where I have less information when it comes to the price point. And so I'm not quite sure about that one. But you get each one of these has a ton of cards, four heroes and minions. And so it's a cool expansion. Of course, you need the main set first because you need the board and all that stuff. So you might as well just start there and just play it. And if you like it, lean into it. If you don't, don't. And it's a really cool game. And I love the fact that they really did stress that affordability is like a feature, really. My understanding is that they had a Kickstarter and took it down because they found a different manufacturer who could do the same quality for a lower price, and that they wanted to do that so they can get into game stores at a reasonable price. And so that's the kind of stuff that I am really excited about. Just accessibility of games is very important. So anyway, in the link down below, or in the description down below, I should say, you'll find a whole bunch of links, everything from gameplay tutorials to talking all about links to their website mainly, and then the card databases and that kind of stuff where people have already done incredible reviews and that kind of stuff. I just wanted to talk about the product because PVP Geeks was kind enough to send me a copy and I wanted to talk about it. So anyway, if you have any questions about it, I do have, like I said, all the rule books and the expansion, that kind of stuff. Leave them in the comments down below. If there's anything useful or helpful, I'll pin it to the top so that you can make a smart decision. Thank you all so much for watching. Happy Wargaming.